Okay, so we're going to continue with some more papers on summarization from the 90s. The first one is by Mitra et al., a group from Cornell University. It was the first paper to use graph-based summarization techniques using, for the first time, a corpus of encyclopedia articles. So the idea was that you want to represent each sentence in the encyclopedia article as a node in a graph and connect the nodes using semantic hyperlinks when the content of those sentences overlaps. So the idea of overlap here is defined as some lexical similarity above a threshold. So for example, multiple words in common. So the idea was that the paths that link highly connected paragraphs are more likely to contain information central to the topic of the article. So you have this kind of representation. And if you start from the first sentence of the document, and you only follow paths that connect you to highly connected paragraphs, you're going to produce a reasonable summary of the encyclopedia article. Okay, so we're going to continue with some more techniques from the late 90s. Next one is by Mani and Bodorn from MITRE 97 and 99. So this was essentially the second time people looked at multi-document summarization. So they also used the graph-based method for identifying similarities and differences between documents based on a single event or sequence of events. The nodes in the document are entities, and the relations correspond to edges. And there are different relation types, for example, same when the entity is the same, adjacent when it appears near each other, alpha, which is related to semantics in WordNet, and coref when the two are coreferent. So here's an example here. We have an entity in the second paragraph between leader, an entity called leaders, another one called Tupac Amaru, and those are connected by adjacency. Chief and Victor Pole are connected by adjacency. Chief and leader are connected by an alpha relation type, and so on. So this kind of graph was used to identify if two documents contain the same entities and should be summarized separately or not. And they use the technique called spreading activation, very similar to the one used by Mitra et al., to identify the most important nodes that need to be highlighted in the summaries. The next paper is by Regina Barzilai and Michael Elhadad, 1997, based on the idea of lexical chain. So what's a lexical chain? Lexical chain is a sequence of words that are semantically connected, so because they are synonyms or hypernyms or appear together or just the same. So here's an example from the paper. Mr. Kenny is the person that invented an anesthetic machine which uses microcomputers to control the rate at which an anesthetic is pumped into the blood, period. Such machines, as you can see, machines is used for the second time, are nothing new. But his device, so now I have device, which is a word that is similar to machine, uses two microcomputers, again, a word that was used before, to achieve much closer monitoring of the pump. So again, pump is similar to pumped before, feeding the anesthetic, which is related to a word that was in the previous sentence. And finally, we have into the patient, where patient is related to person. So we have several lexical chains here. One is consistent of machine, machines, and device. Another one is pumped and pump, and so on. So the idea was to identify the longest lexical chains and then to pick the sentences that contain as many of those chains as possible. So the relations come from WordNet. Some of them are extra strong. That corresponds to actual repetitions of the exact same word. Others are considered strong, for example, synonyms and hypernyms. And others are medium strong. Those are just links between some synsets when the link is longer than one. So for scoring the chains, the very simple formula was used based on the length and the homogeneity index. So the homogeneity index tells you how many of the words come from the same lexical chain. And then the sentences that contain the highest scores are produced as part of the output. So that interesting work was by Daniel Marco as part of his PhD thesis at the University of Toronto and later at ISI in the late 90s. So his approach for summarization is based on text coherence, specifically based on the so-called rhetorical structure theory by Mann and Thompson from 1988. In rhetorical structure theory, you have connections between adjacent utterances or adjacent sentences, which have some sort of rhetorical connection. So for example, if I say, I like cats, period, they make me feel happy. The second sentence, they make me feel happy, gives some additional information about the reasons why I like cats. So in rhetorical structure theory, these kind of relationships are called rhetorical relations, and they usually consist of nucleus and satellite. So the nucleus is an important piece of the relation, and the satellite is an optional piece of the relation. So an example here is evidence. We have a nucleus in the first few words, followed by a satellite. So the nucleus here is, the truth is that the pressure to smoke in junior high is greater than it will be at any other time of one's life. That's the claim. And then we know that 3,000 teens start smoking each day. That is the satellite. So you can easily see that the nucleus contains the more important information, the one that cannot be omitted in the summary, whereas the satellite is the optional information that can be omitted if necessary. So based on this kind of framework, Marco built his rhetorical parser and used it for text summarization. So in this example here, we have the tenet of rhetorical structure theory that says that the nucleus and satellite combination increases the reader's belief in the nucleus. So the purpose of the satellite is to make the nucleus stronger. Let's see now how we can use this technique for automatic summarization. So here we have a short article about the weather conditions on Mars. And it has been separated into 10 individual chunks. RST doesn't work at the level of sentences. It rather works at the level of clauses or utterances. So that's why here in this example, we have sentences split into multiple utterances. So you can read this story left to right just by going 1 to 10, and you will see what it is about. But now what we want to do here is to build a rhetorical parse tree that corresponds to this document and see how we can use it to summarize it. So what is the summary going to look like? We want to pick the one or two or three or perhaps more utterances that contain the most important information in this document. And we're going to use the rhetorical structure of the document to determine which ones are the most important. Okay, so here's a slightly reshuffled version of this document. I did it so that we can more easily build the rhetorical tree, but it's still the same idea. We can read the document left to right by numbers. Okay, so now what's the connection between utterance 1 and utterance 2? Well, it turns out that we have an instance of background or justification. And number 2, sentence number 2 is the nucleus, sentence number 1 is the satellite. Similarly, sentences 5 and 6 can be combined using evidence or cause, and the nucleus is 5. Then we have contrast, which is a binuclear relation. And that's why we propagate both 4 and 5 to the next level, because in a binuclear relation, both of the input clauses are nuclei. Then we have an elaboration that consists of sentence number 3 as the nucleus and what's left in 4, 5, and 6 as the satellite. Then we join 2 and 3, again using an elaboration relation with 2 as the nucleus. Now on the right-hand side, we combine 7 and 8 using concession with 8 as the nucleus. We combine 9 and 10 using antithesis as the relation with 10 as the nucleus. Then we combine the concession 8 with the antithesis 10 into an example relation with 8 as the nucleus. And finally, we combine the two existing topmost nodes, 2 elaboration and 8 example, using another instance of elaboration. And just as with the previous one, the nucleus is utterance number 2. So you can see that now we have the root of this document is sentence number 2. And if we wanted to produce a summary that consists of only one sentence, we would just go and traverse this tree starting from the root going down. And we are going to pick sentence number 2 as the summary. So in this case, that's the sentence, Mars experiences frigid weather conditions. So according to this model, this sentence contains the most information and is the one that should be picked if we are limited to a summary of size 1. So let me explain this in a little bit more detail. I've used now the following notation. A dashed box or dashed line indicates a satellite relation, and a solid box or solid line indicates a nucleus relation. So the first sentence that will be picked if you want to produce a one sentence summary, as we said, is sentence number two. And we get to that sentence by just traversing only nucleus edges starting at the root. Now, if you want to pick the next sentences, we can do this by allowing one satellite in addition to the nuclei. So that takes us to sentences number three and number eight. Why those? Because sentence three is the satellite of a nucleus, and sentence number eight is the nucleus of a satellite. So those sentences are the second most important in the document, and so on. Okay, the next type of approaches to summarization have to deal with noisy channel models. We mentioned noisy channel models in a different section. I'm just going to briefly remember them here. In the noisy channel model, you have the concept of a source and a target language, for example, English and French, and you want to consider one of them as to be a garbled version of the other one. So the garbled version is obtained through some sort of a coding process, for example, that converts English to French. And then if you want to translate back from French to English, you have to decode the same string to get back the original sentence. So you have English to a noisy channel becomes French, and then you recover or decode and get the most likely English sentence that corresponds to the French sentence. So there were a few papers around 1999-2000 by Vibhu Mittal, Adam Berger, and Michael Whitbrock, and a few other people on something called ultra-summarization or headline generation, where they considered the document to be one of the languages, and then the headline or the title of the document to be a shorter version or a translated version of that document. So one of the systems called Ocelot was used for this type of summarization called gisting. And again, the idea was to find the gist that maximizes the probability of the gist given the document. And again, using a Bayesian model, that corresponds to the product of two models. One is the language model of the gists. So you want a gist that is a grammatical English sentence, but you also want the gist to be highly correlated with the document. Therefore, it should contain the words that are important and indicative of the document. So in the other paper of the same idea, there was a training set of 100,000 summary and document pairs, testing on 1,000 pairs, using Viterbi decoding for identifying the most likely translation. And the evaluation that was used was word overlap against the original headlines of the documents for the test set. So here's an example of an output of the auto-summarization system, given a document about the birding society in Savannah. Again, this is a headline produced from a fairly large document by keeping the most important words and yet still preserving as grammatical an output as possible. So one other paper from that same time period was by Jaime Carbonell and Jade Goldstein, CIGAR 98, which introduced the idea of maximal marginal relevance, or MMR, not to be confused with MRR, which is a metric for question answering. So MMR tells you that even if you have two documents that are relevant to the same query, if the two documents are very similar to each other, you don't want to show both of them to the user, because once you've shown one of them to the user, the value or the marginal value of the second one is actually very small. You don't want to get, for example, 10 copies of the same document as output of your query, even though each of them are fairly relevant, just because they're too similar to each other. You would rather have some different documents which individually may not be as relevant, but still would be different enough from the previous ones to give you some more diversity in the output. So MMR is essentially a greedy selection method. It applies practically to query-based summaries, and it's based on this idea of the diminishing return law. So you don't want to get too many good documents that are too similar to each other. So here's an example. Suppose that C is a collection of documents, Q is a user query, and R is a relevance based on a search engine given the query and the collection. And S are documents that have already been retrieved. So for example, let's say you have already retrieved the one most relevant document. You want to decide what other document you want to retrieve. And when I say document, that is essentially an information retrieval scenario, but the same metric applied for summarization deals with sentences. So in this case, we would have the first sentence that is more similar to the query, and now we are going to the stage where we want to pick the second sentence to return. In both cases, document or sentence, we want to pick something that is both relevant to the query and different from the sentences or documents that have already been produced. So the MMR value is essentially computed as it looks like here. It's the document D sub I that belongs to the relevant set R, given the documents that have already been retrieved S. And as you can see, it's a mixture of two different scores. One is how similar that document is to the original query, that's sim1 of D sub I to the query. And the second one is how similar that sentence is from all the sentences in S that have already been selected. And by varying the parameter alpha, one can put more or less emphasis on the diversity value. Again, this is a very important principle that has been very influential in information retrieval and summarization and many other applications, and has resulted in this whole research area of diversity-based re-ranking, which also appears in the machine learning community and user retrieval communities and so on. Another paper from that time period is MEAD, was developed around 2000. It's a general purpose framework for extractive summarization based on salience. So by salience, MEAD means the idea of a centroid of a collection of sentences. I'm going to explain this in the next few slides. I want to say that because MEAD is extractive, it works very well in many different languages. So here's how the centroid-based method works. Suppose that you have a set of sentences from different documents that are represented as dots in some vector space. Then you want to cluster them into topics. So you have, let's say, one cluster on the left, one cluster on the right, and the red circles represent the so-called centroids, centers of mass of the individual clusters. Then you pick from each cluster the sentences that are most similar to the centroid, and then possibly after performing some diversity-based re-ranking using MMR, you pick the sentences that remain that are both similar to the centroids and different from one another. So this method works both for single and multi-document summarization. And MEAD in general uses some additional features, not just centroid. It also uses position, for example, whether the sentence is the first one in the document, length. If the sentence is too short, you don't want to include it, and so on. It also uses a technique called the cross-document structure theory, which I'm going to explain a little bit later. By the way, MEAD is one of the most commonly used methods for extractive summarization, and it includes an open source library that can be downloaded from www.summarization.com. So let's see how the centroid works in principle. You have a vector space representation of the documents and sentences, and alpha is a measure of the similarity between a given document or sentence and the centroid of the cluster. And then the similarity is measured using a standard cosine similarity formula between the document and the centroid. So that is essentially the normalized dot product of the vector corresponding to the document and the vector corresponding to the centroid. So the input for MEAD is a cluster of D documents with N sentences and a compression rate, which is equal to R. And the output is N times R sentences from the cluster, the ones that have the highest scores. So it's a linear combination of the centroid, positional, and other features. So MEAD was used in the early 2000s in News in Essence, which was a system for summarizing news articles on the web. This is a snapshot from the system as it appeared in 2001. As you can see at, on the left, it contains a summary right in the large block of white background text in the middle. And then on the right-hand side, you have all the different clusters that correspond to the different topics of the day. There are other systems that around that time that were built for web-based news summarization. I'm going to show you some of them in the next few slides. One is News Blaster from Columbia, McEwen et al. which is still in existence. And another one from, which started around that time was Google News, which is also still in existence to this day. Okay, so with this, we're going to conclude this current segment on text summarization. There will be more segments later on.